Okay, well, welcome. My name is Timothy Byars. I am the director of cannabis programs at Pacific College and the president and chief education officer at Radicle Health. This is our fourth and last lecture in the director lecture series. This one's called The Iron Triangle. And tonight we're going to discuss how political theory can help explain how we've arrived at this legislative crossroads of cannabis reform. And I'll just move ahead. You can see all of the recordings for these lectures on the Radicle Health YouTube channel. Before I start tonight, I do want to acknowledge that many of the ideas that we'll discuss tonight are not, in fact, my own. In fact, the scaffolding of this lecture I've leveraged from this white paper from the Center for Effective Public Management at the Brookings Institute by Wallach and Roche. You can find this and download this paper easily just by using a couple of keywords. I recommend that you do read the source material for additional information about the concepts that we'll discuss tonight. The concept of bootleggers and Baptists is a bit older. It was coined by a regulatory economist, Bruce Yandel. And he developed this idea to help describe how regulations can be supported by moral crusaders, as well as by groups that really just intend to simply profit from regulations. And often support for a specific regulation can make for some strange bedfellows, which is certainly what we see in the cannabis space. So let's start here. In 2015, voters in Ohio voted against an initiative to adopt a legal cannabis model. This initiative was it would have restricted commercial cannabis production to about 10 sites. All of those sites were owned by the supporters of the initiative, who contributed about $20 million for this initiative to pass. And while the voters and even many cannabis advocates could recognize the boldly self-serving terms of the proposal, Wallach and Roche suggest that this initiative served as kind of like a warning beacon in the cannabis legalization space. Special interest politics and bureaucratic priorities were beginning to take shape around cannabis reform, and this trend would likely increase as more states and the federal government consider new cannabis legalization. So cannabis was effectively banned at the federal level in 1937. At the state level, California had begun to prohibit cannabis as early as 1913. And today, despite some, you know, rather serious legislative sword rattling, cannabis remains illegal at the federal level. That's nearly a century of federal prohibition. So how is it that legalization of cannabis at the state level was possible after decades and decades of overwhelming resistance? So what changed? And then also what remains the same? I do want to start with a bit of light political theory, specifically around drug policy. So drug policy is a legislative thicket. It has to balance these two opposing visions for society. On one side, there's the individual's autonomy, and then on the other, a state's obligation to protect society from what it deems as corrupting appetites. And this contradiction begs a question. Are drug laws really designed to protect the general public? So in political science, there exists a theory called public choice. And this theory suggests that laws and regulations are typically not created for some inherent good that ultimately benefits the general public. Rather, the theory of public choice suggests that laws are created specifically to meet the demands of special interest groups. Now, some political theorists even suggest that bureaucratic agencies actually serve the regulatory interests of those that the agencies are designed to oversee, and that the legislators themselves are simply another group looking after their own self-interests, sometimes by selling public policy to the highest bidder. And this idea that bureaucratic agencies actually serve the regulatory interests of those that the agencies are designed to oversee, it's a bit of a cynical perspective about government. However, the idea was brought into sharp relief during the Trump administration, as many of his appointments had a history of conflict with the agencies that they were selected to lead. For example, Donald Trump selected Scott Pruitt to head the Environmental Protection Agency. As Attorney General of Oklahoma, Pruitt made his entire career about suing the EPA. He did it more than a dozen times. Pruitt was instrumental in the Trump administration's decision to leave the Paris Climate Agreement. And Pruitt made headlines when he openly questioned the science of human-caused climate change. Furthermore, Pruitt hired a former banker, this guy named Albert Kelly, to lead the nation's Superfund program. This was, of course, a program designed to clean up the nation's most contaminated land. Despite the fact that Kelly had no experience with environmental policy whatsoever, and incidentally, just prior to Kelly's appointment, the FDIC had given him a lifetime ban from working in banking and labeled him unfit to serve. So Pruitt would eventually be forced out due to a number of ethics investigations. The Sierra Club executive director, Michael Brune, released this statement about Pruitt's successor, and this was a man named Andrew Wheeler. He was a coal industry lobbyist. So when Wheeler was tapped to head the agency, Brune said, quote, he, meaning Wheeler, fought against safeguards to limit mercury poisoning. He fought against protections to limit the amount of ozone in our skies. He fought against air pollution from neighboring states. He's a climate denier, so sadly, he fits in well with EPA leadership, end quote. In 2018, Trump appointed Jeffrey Clark, the Attorney General for the Environment and Natural Resources Division. This is the nation's top environmental lawyer. Clark made a living representing oil industry clients, including representing BP in lawsuits for the Deepwater Horizon 2010 oil spill. Then, in a defining hold my beer moment, Trump appointed Rick Perry to the head of the United States Department of Energy, whose mission is to develop technology and education for efficient energy sources. Previously, during his bid for president in 2012, Perry stated that he thought the federal government should eliminate the Department of Energy. Again, these are examples that support the idea that bureaucratic agencies and those that run them actually serve the regulatory interests of those that the agencies are designed to oversee. So tonight, we want to explore how the theory of public choice can help us understand the history and maybe even the future of legal cannabis reform, especially at the federal level. And at the very least, it might help us understand the coalitions and strange bedfellows that have and continue to support cannabis prohibition. So it's no secret that government bureaucrats recruited cannabis as public enemy number one to improve their own circumstances. We can likely point to the Harrison Act of 1914 as kind of the beginning of prohibitive federal drug policy in America. There was the Pure Food and Drug Act that was enacted about 8 years earlier, but that was mainly an act that required proper labeling on substances. The Harrison Act of 1914 imposed an excise tax on things like opium and coca leaves and other opiates and derivatives. And at the time, the Internal Revenue Bureau's new narcotics division, this would later become the Federal Bureau of Narcotics, and then eventually it would become the DEA. And they were charged with drug enforcement and asking about for anything to justify their mission after alcohol prohibition failed. They promoted cannabis to a dangerous menace in 1937. And despite a solid 50 years of propaganda and commensurate low opinion of cannabis among the public, public approval of cannabis legalization began to steadily rise beginning in 1990, and states began to pass cannabis reform in the late 90s. And yet these developments have still not translated into federal cannabis reform. So what's the disconnect here? So public choice theory suggests that a number of groups with self-interest in federal cannabis prohibition, who collectively make up an entity referred to as the Iron Triangle of anti-cannabis interests, have dominated the cannabis policy debate and have, until very recently, ensured the status quo of prohibition. In the Brookings Institute white paper, Wallach and Roche, they refer to this as the Iron Triangle, but also they refer to it as Baptists, bootleggers, and bureaucrats. And the combined influence of these groups has thwarted federal cannabis reform, even as public support of for cannabis has increased. So we want to take a closer look at each of these groups. So let's start here. So Baptists is a figurative and I confess a rather clumsy and potentially offensive label to refer to all of the moralists and politicians and public health advocates who believe cannabis use is harmful or inherently wrong. And I'm going to refer to this group going forward as the moralists at the sacrifice okay. of the cheeky alliteration. The moralists don't have necessarily any financial self-interest in cannabis prohibition. Rather, they have moral objections to cannabis legalization. So this group justifies the criminalization of cannabis sales and possession by suggesting that this approach reduces use and sends an unambiguous social message of disapproval. Now, this is despite decades of proof that this approach does little, if anything, to eliminate or even mitigate cannabis use. But this philosophy has remained the de facto position among legislators for nearly a century because it's been framed as the most respectable position. Of course, the prohibition of cannabis has pushed its distribution and use into organized crime. So part of the cannabis stigma is that it is inherently linked to criminal and antisocial behavior. Furthermore, cannabis use in the 60s became a cultural signal for expressing disapproval for government policies and traditional values. And while moralists are not necessarily protecting a financial self-interest, they are very well represented in politics. Politicians, especially on the right, are mostly drawn from the ranks of the moralists, or at least profess publicly to identify with this group. And these politicians provide a consistent defense of the cannabis prohibition status quo, simply as a matter of course. Furthermore, when this moral latent interest dovetails with very narrow financial interests, it solidifies the prohibition status quo even further. Let's consider, if we must, Mitch McConnell, who, for example, pushed through hemp legislation in 2018 for the farm bill for his home state of Kentucky. He even used a hemp pen to sign the bill. But Mitch has remained an intransigent obstacle to cannabis legalization, not even allowing a single cannabis bill to see the Senate floor for a vote during his time as Senate Majority Leader. McConnell has a clear financial motivation for opposing federal cannabis legalization because there's a thriving hemp farming industry in his home state of Kentucky. If cannabis were legalized nationwide, it would present a competitive threat to hemp farmers in his state. So this group, the moralists, continues to campaign for cannabis prohibition through the formation of parent and family groups, and by mobilizing around perceived threats to children. So the so-called parent movement began in the 1970s to campaign against cannabis decriminalization. And from this movement would be born institutional entities, including National Families of Action, the Community Alliances for Drug-Free Youth, and then more recently, groups like Parents Opposed to Pot, Citizens Against Legalizing Marijuana, the Take Back America, all of these campaigns. Even at local levels, parents who can employ even the most rudimentary organizational strategies can have very profound effects on legislators. I've personally been to a number of city council meetings where council members were visibly influenced by parents who marched in their own children or their entire classroom or their sports team or their Boy Scout troop as an effective prop against any local cannabis reform. Another less obvious agent in this group are public health researchers who create what appear on the surface to be arguments that are morally neutral. We'll also discuss some organizations funded by government in the bureaucratics group. So RAND's Drug Policy Research Center, which was founded in 1989, has been historically the most important center for these kinds of voices. So this value neutral and academic tone and putative empirical data tends to lend support to the status quo by myopically focusing on the idea that cannabis is physically and socially harmful, usually with no consideration for any appropriate use or therapeutic benefits of responsible cannabis use or to the social costs of the war on drugs. So the second group in the Iron Triangle, so we had the moralists. The second group in the Iron Triangle is the bootleggers. So this group includes those that have an underlying financial interest in cannabis prohibition. Now, the obvious prototype is, of course, the illicit market alcohol importers and distillers that thrived during alcohol prohibition and who were able to use their influence largely through bribery to prolong prohibition and manipulate its enforcement. The modern drug war equivalent, which would be like well-financed cartels and gangs and, you know, small-time growers, definitely seems to be less influential, at least here in the U.S. And likely these groups have not contributed directly to drug laws, except by drawing the ire of politicians and police and the public and serving as a convenient scapegoat, and thereby mobilizing prohibitionist forces and cementing the status quo. However, there are additional groups that fall into this bootlegger category and can and do influence policy. First, there exist loosely organized coalitions of the cannabis industry itself that consistently vote against cannabis reform. And the reasons can vary. Some people in the cannabis industry feel that new legislation will be costly or it might exclude them from participating altogether. You know, we have generations of growers, for example, in some states who have been systematically left out of emerging industries. So this fear has certainly been borne out in many states, and many states have barriers that prevent small businesses from accessing licenses or accessing funding. Some people in the industry currently have footholds in existing but limited legalized markets, and they don't see any advantage in opening the market to more competition. You know, consider clinicians in medical-only markets who have captive audiences, right? If you live in one of these states, it's a medical-only state. If you want to use cannabis in one of those states, you have to pay a clinician to give you a recommendation. This revenue stream effectively evaporates as soon as you pass adult use in a state. And then some people in the industry fear that government regulation will just ruin the industry with too many restrictions that are inherently hostile to cannabis users, things like high taxes, short lists of qualifying conditions, impairment laws, additional police funding and enforcement. And again, these fears have, in fact, been borne out in many state reform models. Another group included in the bootlegger category are those who profit from mandated treatment business. So every year, hundreds of thousands of individuals are still arrested for cannabis possession or fail mandatory drug tests. And usually they're given a choice. You can serve prison time or lose your job or go to a juvenile detention center, or you can enter this mandatory treatment program. And in fact, about 57% of all individuals in cannabis treatment and dependence treatment are there as a result of a court order. So the treatment industry is in fact dependent on a stream of customers sent by police and criminal courts. And then the last group included in the bootlegger category are those organizations that or industries that consider the cannabis market as competition. You know, generally we look at the industries of big alcohol and big pharma. Surprisingly, big alcohol has been conspicuously silent on this matter, at least publicly. There are some examples that exist of big alcohol contributing to anti-cannabis reform campaigns, You know, there was the California Beer and Beverage Distributors. They gave about 10 grand to an anti-legalization campaign in 2010. But more recently, it seems like alcohol companies are no longer really viewing cannabis as a substitute, but rather as a complement. Or maybe they're angling to ensure that cannabis legalization favors their own participation. So, for example, by advocating for things like bans on personal grows or limiting the number of commercial licenses to ensure inflated prices or lobbying for high taxes and so forth. But they're doing all of this through lobbyists and behind closed doors. Or maybe they're just simply using their existing economies of scale and they plan to join and dominate the industry as soon as we have federal legalization. And then, of course, we have big pharma. You know, broader legalization and access to cannabis products reduces the bottom line of pharmaceutical companies. This is a bit of speculation on my behalf, but the fact that the Cannabis Opportunity and Administration Act delegates a lot of cannabis regulation to the FDA, that kind of has big pharma's fingerprints all over it. It's not clear what new processes or definitions the FDA would apply to the cannabis industry and cannabis products should something like the Cannabis Opportunity Act pass, but traditionally, FDA approval of any substance requires hundreds of millions of dollars and would really prevent most small cannabis manufacturing companies from participating, and thereby, you know, severely limiting the market and competition with big pharma. So those are the bootleggers. The third group in the Iron Triangle are the bureaucrats. This includes a collection of some of the largest and most active groups who advocate for continued cannabis prohibition. And these groups and individuals are actually part of the government, or at least directly dependent on government funding. And their interests usually are cloaked in altruism and public health, but they mostly seem financial. First up is law enforcement. So police officials and public prosecutors will argue that relaxing cannabis laws will compromise established and effective patterns of policing. However, even a cursory look at law enforcement budgets suggests more of a bootlegger type of motivation. But beginning in the 1930s, asset forfeiture and proceeds from the illicit market have become an important source of law enforcement revenue at the federal, state, and certainly at the local level. In 1984, the Comprehensive Crime Act allowed local police departments to simply keep all of the proceeds from seized assets. So this is a quote from New Frontier Data. This is an organization that produces studies and industry reports covering cannabis industry topics. So they did a report on asset seizure, and they said this: civil forfeiture laws allow police to seize property, cash, cars, houses, guns, and other assets suspected of being connected to criminal activity, independently of whether criminal charges are ever filed. While the original intent of civil asset forfeiture was to disrupt large-scale organized drug trafficking and to fight the war on drugs, overwhelming evidence shows that the programs exercised at the state and local levels offer too few protections for innocent property owners, while simultaneously offering perverse profit incentives for police and prosecutors. And even those people who have the financial means to go to court to fight for the return of their unfairly seized assets, they often face another major obstacle. There's a low standard of proof required to seize property under most civil forfeiture laws. Again, this is a quote from New Frontier Data. They say, quote, under civil asset forfeiture, the property itself is charged with the crime, not the person. And unlike when a person is prosecuted for the crime, the property is effectively seen as guilty until proven innocent, with the burden of proof falling on the property owner, end quote. So predictably, police departments have shifted their policing practices to an emphasis on the enforcement of drug laws. So for example, a Florida County Sheriff's Department's annual strategic plan, which was leaked to the public, described asset seizures from cannabis arrests as critical to, quote, meet eligible equipment or other non-recurring needs that could not be met by local funding, end quote. So furthermore, you know, we have law enforcement professionals and organizations with expertise in drug enforcement. They're naturally going to take a special interest in opposing decriminalization. Their professional standing and their paychecks rely on it. Unless you think I'm embellishing or that asset forfeiture is only related to serious illicit drug trafficking, I'll relay an example from my own county, Contra Costa County. It's a somewhat sleepy but growing San Francisco Bay Area suburb. We have a population of just over 1 million. The district attorney's office in Contra Costa County was court ordered to disclose cash seizures that totaled approximately 1.1 million from cases where the district attorney's office decided not to file criminal charges, but they still kept the cash. Nearly half of that 1.1 million came from cannabis arrests alone. And about 29% of that money was tied to actual charges being filed. So about 70% of that money came from seizures where there weren't even any criminal charges that were filed. And this data is from 2015 to 2018. Medical cannabis has been legal in California since 1996. Adult use was implemented in January of 2018. This is happening in California. So there are two federal offices that have played a critical role in framing the debates around cannabis policy. Both offices have broad anti-drug research and anti-drug education mandates. Those organizations are the National Institute on Drug Abuse, or NIDA, and NIDA is housed within the National Institutes of Health, and the White House Office of National Drug Control Policy, ONDCP, but most people just refer to this as the Drug Czar's Office. So in their paper, Wallach and Roche have noted that both entities are constitutionally committed to America's drug war, not only domestically, but also internationally, given that the U.S. has long been an anti-drug proselytizer and has built anti-drug mandates into treaties and have tied these mandates to global funding. So simply by virtue of their mandates and organizational placements, these organizations have the same type of bureaucratic self-interest as Anslinger and the Federal Bureau of Narcotics in emphasizing the threats posed by cannabis and in defending the idea that cannabis is a dangerous illicit drug. So funding from the federal government, funding that you provide, goes toward advertising campaigns to promote prevention, things like the National Youth Anti-Drug Media Campaign and the Above the Influence Campaign, but also to support youth education programs. And most notably, when we talk about those kinds of programs, we're really talking about DARE, or the Drug Abuse Resistance Education Program. So importantly, these offices project the authority of the federal government to the side of anti-cannabis status quo. And NIDA is hugely influential in the US, in US cannabis research, because it has a legal monopoly on the production of cannabis for all scientific testing. It administers this kind of cannabis in cooperation with the University of Mississippi. And this seems like an obvious conflict of interest, given that NIDA is legally devoted to minimizing the harms of drug abuse and is therefore skeptical of any appropriate or useful purpose of cannabis. NIDA also holds the purse strings for cannabis research, and predictably they funnel money to cannabis-related research, mostly when that research is looking at harm reduction. So this research bias influences the public health community, it influences the medical community, it influences the general public, you know, especially those people who are, or organizations who are just too busy or too lazy to really do any digging, right? So, if NIDA states that cannabis is bad for your health or it's a dangerous drug, who am I to argue? So we have these moral crusaders, parents, religious leaders, law enforcement agencies of every stripe, federal bureaucracies, drug treatment providers. These interest groups who campaign against cannabis legalization are formidable. And yet here we are, what seems like a tipping point and on the verge of possibly some federal cannabis reform. So how did we get here? Again, I want to go back to the theory of public choice. And the theory of public choice, it states that in order to disrupt a long existing, well-defended policy regime, advocates of change need to do at least two things. They need a shift in public opinion, and then they need a reconfiguration of the interest group landscape. Now, in our previous lecture, we discussed how and speculated on possibly why public opinion changed on the cannabis issue. You can review that lecture on the Radicle Health YouTube channel. So today we're going to focus on the second one, which is the reconfiguration of the interest group landscape. And generally, cannabis reform has succeeded because cannabis advocates have changed their message and have changed the manner in which they deliver the message. So prior to 2012, cannabis advocates would argue unsuccessfully that any drug use is a fundamental personal right. And for responsible users, cannabis can actually improve personal well-being. Most of us remember the famous photo of Allen Ginsberg holding the sign that read, "Pot is fun," right? Regardless of the objective strength of these arguments, neither of them found much resonance with the broader public, possibly because the original cannabis messengers tended to be proudly marginalized by traditional communities and values. I might also suggest that it's hard to sell cannabis reform to the middle of the country when the messengers look like these two gentlemen. One sporting two pigtails and a pig pot, pork pie hat. Usually when I see Steve, he's in a disheveled suit. And the other gentleman usually wears a wedding dress. Now, this is not to disparage either of these two men or to undermine or to diminish the contributions they've made to cannabis reform. Those contributions have been significant. In fact, these two men have done more than most for cannabis reform. I'm only suggesting that moving the needle of cannabis acceptance outside of the cannabis bubble required work from inside the mainstream, especially on the policy front. All levels of government were aligned in support of prohibition, and the cannabis message and the cannabis messengers really made few, if any, inroads into building institutional, bureaucratic, or government sector support for legalization prior to 2012. So let's go back to how we arrived at this current tipping point. How did cannabis advocates disrupt the prohibition paradigm and start seeing campaign victories over the Iron Triangle? A few things happened. First, money happened. Money transformed the organizational side of the legalization movement. And we can really point to the work of two billionaire philanthropists. One is George Soros. He gave about $80 million to drug policy research and advocacy since about 1994. And the other is the late Peter B. Lewis, who spent about $40 to $60 million on cannabis legalization between 1980 and his death in 2013. And these were the contributions that funded the work of organizations like the Drug Policy Alliance and the Marijuana Policy Project, as well as funding the work of the American Civil Liberties Union. And these are organizations that really helped to transform the debate over cannabis legalization. But the money itself was not sufficient. Legalization and decriminalization campaigns frequently and massively outspent opponents in ballot issues between 2000 and 2012. And there were very few successes prior to 2012. But better funded organizations do produce better strategies. And cannabis reformers reframed their message from an individual right to a socially responsible public health issue. So for many pivotal groups of voters, the how of cannabis legalization is critical. So recall from our previous lecture how media coverage and state campaigns can influence outcomes. So for example, the coverage in Colorado focused on how competent state agencies might approach the regulatory processes of legalizing cannabis. And that amendment, Amendment 64, passed in 2012. And then conversely, one of the first adult use legalization campaigns in California failed. This was Prop 19. And the media narratives that framed legalization campaigns for Prop 19 framed them as sort of like free-for-alls for the industry. Prop 19 failed despite being very well funded. So this good government pitch reconfigured the interest groups, and especially political interest groups, because these reforms needed to be perceived as responsible and politically acceptable. Furthermore, cannabis advocates shifted their message to highlight and attack the staggering costs of the drug war, especially on Black and Latino communities, rather than focusing on any benefits or moral entitlement issues. Incidentally, this message also successfully marries the widespread sense that alcohol prohibition was a severe regulatory misstep with a message that public health risks from cannabis are no more threatening, and in fact, far less threatening than those of alcohol. And for the past 20 years, pro-legalization groups have promoted the message that cannabis should simply be regulated like alcohol rather than forced into a dangerous illicit market. And legalization advocates brought in a variety of institutional voices to question cannabis prohibition, including groups like the NAACP and the League of United Latin American Citizens. And these organizations could speak with a certain moral authority about the costs of the drug war in their communities. Leaders of recent legalization campaigns, including the Marijuana Policy Project, sought and received endorsements from Black and Latino organizations for their ballot initiatives. Now, a longstanding and significant disadvantage of cannabis reform was a public perception that cannabis reformers themselves represented special interest groups, groups that often self-alienated from the broader public. And those two groups are, you know, stoners and lifestyle libertarians. And conversely, prohibition forces included government agencies and law enforcement community and public health experts and religious communities and parent groups and school administrators. You know, this was a coalition that could convincingly lay claim to speak for the public interest. But cannabis reformers began making inroads because they inverted what Wallach and Roche refer to as the special interest calculus. So they argued that police departments shouldn't be wasting their limited resources busting kids for cannabis possession and clogging up court systems. Cannabis reform, they argued, would free up resources to devote to dangerous criminals. In other words, reformers reframed legalization as a law and order reform, even to go so far as to suggest that cannabis reform is a tough on crime type of reform. So by taxing cannabis and earmarking tax revenues for education and public health, reformers reframed legalization as something that could strengthen schools and strengthen youth prevention and education efforts. So part of that reconfiguring the public interest landscape is to reimagine an issue in such a way that special interest groups recognize their own forthcoming benefits after reform. So let's look at two of those groups. So public health groups that focus on adverse effects. Sorry, I think I'm one slide behind. Public interest groups public health groups that focus on the adverse effects of cannabis, both physically and socially. You know, these are groups that are probably unlikely to become sign-waving advocates of cannabis legalization, but they might be persuaded by the promise of tax revenue from legal cannabis markets for things like youth prevention and treatment and research. And a lot of reform models have monies dedicated to this type of research. So this would continue to be a consistent source of funding for these kinds of groups. The second group, one of the most important special interest groups, elected officials, are now recognizing the potential financial gains from cannabis legalization. So over the past, 5 years or so, legislators have been sort of peering across their state borders to assess how early adopters were faring. And these initially reticent officials are now throwing their weight behind legalization because the revenue stream examples from legal markets are now very clear. This is John Boehner. He was, quote, in his own words, unalterably opposed to cannabis legalization during his 26-year career in the U.S. House of Representatives. Now, John has a pretty cushy job on the board of Acreage Holdings, which is one of the largest companies in the cannabis industry. And his thinking has, in his own words, evolved. The commercial cannabis industry also is beginning to organize. Trade groups like the National Cannabis Industry Association are lobbying state federal legislators on behalf of their own members. Very large cannabis companies like Cresco Labs and Curaleaf, even companies like Scott's Miracle-Gro, which is very embedded in the industry, are able to make large political contributions. They're able to get media attention, and they bring a certain amount of respectability to the industry. All right, let's talk about one last facet that contributed to successful cannabis reform campaigns. During the last century, cannabis advocates have faced the disadvantage of having the latent status quo opinion against them. This disadvantage is rooted in the existing stigma of cannabis use, its association with criminal enterprises, the cultural baggage of cannabis. However, the shift in the cannabis reformer strategy and message has brought with it a corresponding advantage. And that's the overconfidence of reform opponents. It left them a bit flat-footed. And this collection of opponents sort of failed to take legalization efforts seriously. Until very recently, there's been virtually no significant counter-mobilization efforts from prohibitionists. Anti-cannabis campaigns on ballot issues usually have very poor funding, and they're usually very disorganized. Pro-legalization forces have achieved spending advantages of at least like a 3-to-1 and more often like a 10-to-1 advantage. And you can see here in this table that in all of these campaigns, save for one, cannabis advocates outspent their opponents by a wide margin. So the Colorado campaign in 2006 is the exception here in this table. And I put an asterisk there because by the total in the anti-cannabis column, because it's unclear how much of this money actually went to fight Initiative 44, which was the cannabis initiative. Because that same year, these same anti-cannabis groups were also spending money to support Initiative 43, which would change the state constitution to define marriage as a union between a man and a woman. Remember that? By emphasizing responsible regulation, by exploiting surprise and assuming the public interest mantle, cannabis advocates disrupted the Iron Triangle with a success that even cannabis reformers could not have anticipated. It is safe, I think, to now state that the legalization movement has arrived as a force to be reckoned with. However, there are good reasons to think that opponents of cannabis reform will do a better job at counter-mobilization in the future. So legalization opponents, such as the group Smart Approaches to Marijuana, don't be fooled by the name, are already starting to update their message, which is now this. They're now saying, hey, if you allow legal commercialization of cannabis, it's going to end in domination by what Sam refers to as big marijuana firms with the same type of marketing and political clout that can legitimize the use of cannabis, especially among minors, target and exploit problem users because those are the best customers, and also result in cannabis being undertaxed and underregulated. They're really starting to paint the cannabis industry as tobacco 2.0. And Sam is tapping into this anti-business, or more specifically, anti-corporate leanings, which are especially prevalent among progressive voters who might otherwise likely support cannabis legalization. Also, this argument reshifts the burden back onto cannabis reformers. Remember that the drug warriors succeeded in framing the debate as being about the harms of cannabis and placed the burden on legalizers to defend the, you know, the putative, self-destructive lifestyles of potheads. Then cannabis reformers succeeded in reframing the debate as being more about the harms of prohibition and placed the burden on drug warriors to defend the largely ineffective criminalization of a very commonly used substance that's less dangerous than alcohol and tobacco. Once again, now organizations like SAM are seeking to reframe the debate again, this time by making it about the harms of corporate predation and placing the burden back on reformers to defend a giant business lobby that's seeking riches by selling dangerous substances to the most vulnerable Americans, including our children and our seniors. And corporations with their own money and influence can, you know, they can manipulate the regulatory process on behalf of their own bottom line. And the suggestion by organizations like SAM is that big cannabis will use this influence to bury any evidence of harms, and they're gonna block attempts to disrupt the revenue streams, especially those flowing from high volume users. And, you know, SAM's new motto is preventing another big tobacco. So while traditional anti-drug messaging appeals to social conservatives, anti-corporate messaging can resonate with progressives and libertarians. So given the change in public opinion about cannabis and about the war on drugs in general, I would argue that it's unlikely that momentum will shift back to any kind of reinvigorated war on cannabis. Cannabis reform at the federal level, I think, is likely inevitable, but the timing and the implementation will likely occur against a backdrop of better organized, better messaged opposition, especially at the local level. You know, this means that, you know, cannabis might be legal at the federal and state level, but it might not be accessible where you live, especially given that autonomy and the option to opt out of the commercial industry at the county and city level is often a bargaining chip that state legislators use to help pass cannabis reform. So hopefully over time, these, you know, the laboratories of democracy will win out. States with the best regulatory models will provide examples to other states, and regulatory incoherence that now exists will be refined over time. So I want to finish with this. In the white paper, the 2016 white paper, Roche and Wallach state that they don't intend to malign interest group politics, but simply suggest that politics around all issues are influenced by the self-interest of long-term players. So if you're hoping for a federal cannabis reform model that is immune to lobbying and influence, you're likely going to be sorely disappointed. However, Roche and Wallach did conclude, and I think they concluded correctly in my opinion, that whatever regulatory model wins out, it will be better than the model constructed around the criminalization of cannabis, which resulted in a worst case scenario, right? Where products are widely available at low prices, they're of low quality, they're accessible to children, there are no health and safety standards, all of the revenue streams are collected in the illicit market by illegal enterprises, and there exists an uneven enforcement of laws that continue to decimate communities, especially Black and Latino communities. That's all I have for you tonight. Thank you for indulging me. We do have about 11 minutes for questions, and I'll be happy to take comments or questions.